This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close Up.
Well, Iowa took new steps to back the blue legally. The governor signed a law that fulfills her and other Republicans' campaign promise to protect police officers while keeping Iowans safe from violent protests.
Iowa experienced its share of unrest. The Back the Blue Act responds by making rioting a felony. So if you riot, if you loot, if you attack our law officers, then you will be punished to the fullest extent of the law.
The governor was referring to last summer when demonstrations protesting the murder of George Floyd at the hands of a white officer turned violent and destructive. The new law would also increase penalties for protesters blocking streets and highways or those who destroy public property. The bill also strengthens qualified immunity protection for law enforcement, making it more difficult to sue them individually for misconduct. And it also penalizes policies that discourage officers from enforcing laws on the state or local level. KCCI's chief political reporter Cynthia Fodor gets a close-up look at how law enforcement feels about the new law.
Commissioner, first off, how will this new law protect officers and people in law enforcement?
You know, this is really, I know it's been coined as Back the Blue, but in many respects, it's really about community safety. And, you know, for a lot of our officers, this does provide them a measure of safety as well, just as it does for the rest of the community. There's pieces of this legislation in particular that helps protect confidentiality of the officers' home addresses. That is one big piece that has been missing in part, is the ability to remove your home address from the public portion of the county auditor's office, so you can't jump online and quickly find where an officer lives. You know, and that unfortunately is it's an ongoing challenge that we all experience. You know, the other piece of it is concerning qualified immunity. And, you know, I know that there's been much made of how we're expanding qualified immunity. And in some senses, the statute does expand qualified immunity. But really what it does is just bring Iowa in conformance with existing federal law. And what it allows our officers to do is to not constantly second guess themselves. And that is something that we owe the officers, in my opinion, in many respects, is because what I don't want to have is an officer that's afraid to do, or a female officer that's afraid to do what they've been called to do because they're worried about getting sued, that they don't intervene, that they just stay in their car, as opposed to going out and engaging with the public or protecting an individual or taking a dangerous individual off the street. And so it gives them a measure of confidence that they're not going to be constantly second-guessed and exposing themselves to lawsuits.
Have you been seeing more lawsuits along those lines, particularly in the last year?
Yeah, I mean, it's always an ongoing situation. I know not only the Iowa Department of Public Safety, but the Des Moines Police Department, those are lawsuits that are ongoing, and they happen with a fair degree of regularity. And, you know, what is nice with this new law is, as I said, it brings us in conformance with federal law, and it does provide a little better measure of protection to the officers. It creates a situation where they won't have that liability unless they're clearly outside the bounds of the law.
And in this law, we've been hearing a lot about, it also has been called the anti-rioting law, that it increases penalties for protest-related crimes. Will it make much of a difference for officers doing their jobs at a protest?
It will. And I think, again, you know, what it's designed to do is really promote public safety. And the best example I can give, probably in the new law, is the notion of blocking highways. You know, we had situations where state troopers had to respond to Iowa City, or we had individuals that were protesting that blocked Interstate 80. That is an incredibly dangerous activity. You know, first and foremost, you know, when those events occurred this summer, it happened in the middle of the night. So it's dark, and you have 150 people walk onto I-80. And if we don't have advance notice that that's going to occur, the risk, not only to the protesters, but to the traveling public, is enormous.
And along those lines, I mean, several other charges have been raised. The charge of rioting would now be a felony. Would that be a major deterrent, you think?
Yes, I certainly do believe it will be a deterrent.
Another piece of this is the unlawful assembly piece. The ACLU has been somewhat critical of this, saying that it's just too broadly written.
You know, when we look back at even this summer, you know, what we did in almost every occasion was to advise everyone that was present over loudspeakers that this is now becoming an unlawful assembly. You know, please disperse. And then we would wait 5 minutes, and then we'd give them another warning and a third warning. And almost every occasion, we gave them at least three warnings over the span of 15 minutes to advise folks that it had become that. And so that's how we would operate, even under the new laws, to give folks the ample opportunity to understand the dynamics and the shifting notion of a peaceful protest into criminal activity, and give those folks that are engaged in their First Amendment rights the opportunity to leave, to pull away, to extricate themselves from that situation.
Well, Democratic state leaders feel the governor broke her promise to take up justice reform recommendations. A year ago, after the protests died down, Reynolds signed the More Perfect Union Act. It addressed police brutality concerns by banning chokeholds and requiring that police take anti-bias and de-escalation training. It also prohibits rehiring any officer previously fired for serious misconduct. Lawmakers, including those from the Legislative Black Caucus, met this week to voice their concerns.
We last year did a yeoman's work on the Iowa Black Caucus on getting the More Perfect Union, you know, through our Legislative Caucus. We were of one body, we were one accord. That says volumes. This legislation that the governor signed, recently, has shown that we have gone backwards. We have again divided Democrats and Republicans. I think that sends a terrible, terrible message.
Iowa is beginning to be looked at around the country as a state that is going backwards. It sends out a message that we do not want to grow. We do not want to welcome people who want to come here, and we want to maintain status quo. I hope the governor has a visionary aspect to her mentality, that she will soon wake up, realize the message that she is sending out, realize the condition that our state is in, and change her legislative perspective.
They're going to remember. Iowans are going to remember, regardless of party, in terms of what signal signing this bill sends beyond Iowa to the rest of the country. That's going to influence not only opportunity for folks, but it's going to influence our business community and who they're able to bring to Iowa, whether it's in the tech field or supporting even some of the job issues and concerns that are going on in rural Iowa.
It's just an additional example of failed leadership on the part of the governor. And so I have no expectation that she had all session to get something done. We had momentum from last summer, and this session, every opportunity existed to come together. We weren't invited to the table. The recommendations she heard from others were ignored. And so I don't know why a promise she makes now would be kept any more than the promise she made last summer.
And I want to echo that myself. I think Minority Leader Converse is correct. And just to give you kind of a view of how this would work, my concern would be that if we did do something next year, it would simply be an amendment on the current bill that she just now passed. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not interested in doing that. That sets us up to vote for the Back to Bill Blue in a positive manner. And I voted no on that bill. So adding racial profiling to it does not help us. If we're going to do something at all, we need to go back to what we did, the bill that the Iowa Black Caucus did. We can add it to that if we want to do that.
But many, many other actions throughout the session showed a change in tone in dealing with racial issues than I have seen in the six terms that I have been a representative. The attitude in trying to deliberately stop actions around the state that would promote racial coming together were stopped. It's just a real negative, dire tone of we don't want change. That was the big message of this session. We don't see a need for diversity. We don't see a need for collaboration. It is our way or the highway.
Up next, the Democratic challenger is making a play for the governor's office. Representative Ross Smith weighs in on the governor's new law and why he believes he's better fit to lead Iowa.
How would you describe shopping for a new car?
Governor Reynolds has her first challenger. Democratic State Representative Ross Smith is the first to throw his hat into the ring. KCCI's chief political reporter Cynthia Fodor talked with him one-on-one after his big announcement in Waterloo.
You're the first person on the Democratic side. Well, you're the first person to announce on both sides because the governor hasn't made it official yet. And you're the first Black person to run for governor. Why are you throwing your hat in the ring here?
Iowa's my home. My wife and I are proud to raise our daughters here. You know, from my family's strawberry farm to the church that I go to here in Waterloo, my mom is the pastor. Iowa's made me who I am. It's shown me the true meaning of community, but it's also allowed me to understand that we're not just defined by like the work or the jobs that we do. It's about what we're all working towards. And I think Iowans deserve a governor that is worthy of that work. Somebody who's been in their shoes and understands that the goal of the office now should be about returning the power to the people and allowing the people to not have to be perfect, but allowing them to come as they are and be a part of this community. Allow them to be a contributing member of the Iowa that we want to build for the future.
Is this something, Representative, that you've always aspired to, or were you pushed by this session? I know Democrats had a lot of frustration in trying to get their agenda accomplished, given that Republicans control the House, the Senate, and the governor's seat.
For me, it's not something I ever planned to do, to be honest. I never anticipated or planned to be state representative either. You know, sometimes I do believe that, you know, as a man of faith, God puts you in certain situations for a reason. And I believe that in this moment, I'm here to help build bridges, to utilize my lived experiences to demonstrate that as a Black man, I'm still just as much an Iowan as anyone else.
Let's turn to the Back the Blue bill, so-called Back the Blue bill. And I believe you voted against that. Why did you vote against it?
I voted against it because it was not based on the recommendations from the governor's task force, first and foremost. It wasn't in line with the request that law enforcement had made about anti-racial profiling legislation. It wasn't in line with our shared values and goals that we set forth last year after we passed a plan for a perfect union. In my opinion, this was more pandering as opposed to being able to unite folks like we did last year. This was really geared towards political gain and I think just pandering to one group as opposed to moving everything forward.
Well, still ahead, social distance disruption. We go close up into how isolating to keep each other safe negatively affected our mental health.
There's nothing we haven't seen. There's nothing we can't.
Well, this pandemic has been weird, overwhelming, and isolating at times. And as we're getting back to normal, KCCI's Rhea Spigner takes a closer look at the mental effects in a post-pandemic world.
Social isolation. We all have probably sealed ourselves off in some way because of, you know, the pandemic. Well, I spoke with mental health clinician Breanne Ward for a close-up conversation about behaviors found during the pandemic, from heightened anxieties and worries to environmental stressors amplified during isolation. And how fast is too fast to be back outside in the world? This is a close-up look at social isolation and how to move forward.
I'm here with Breanne Ward. She is a mental health clinician, and we are going to talk about social isolation. A lot of us has done at least a little bit of that during this pandemic. So let's get into how we're dealing with it post-pandemic as we're kind of inching our way back to normal, right? So before this, let's talk about some of the anxieties that people might have met before even going into the pandemic or during the pandemic. What are some things that you saw from people, Breanne?
You know, Ray, I saw a lot of anxiety. I saw also a lot of depressive symptoms. Kind of call it the gas pedal brake analogy. So you have people who have racing thoughts, thought rumination, which fuels the anxiety. And then after you get tired, your body says, okay, you can shut down. It starts to look like depression. So, you know, you push the brake pedal. And a lot of the fueling thoughts that were happening with the persons I was serving was, you know, am I going to have enough money? Can I make enough money? Is there enough hours at my job? I think I have people, but do I really have supports? I'm not quite sure. You know, the whole, you know, fake phenomenon, the friends, I have fake friends, fake family members, those kind of things. So kind of working through some of those relational issues as well as basic needs and financial issues. That all was what happening before pandemic.
Okay, so before pandemic, and then you add social isolation to everything that you just said, and that creates what?
So it magnifies those issues. So if you are quote unquote terminated or laid off, if you are already having those thought ruminations about how, it's almost like I'll never. So it becomes like this fixed mindset that was happening with isolation. If I didn't have support, you know, now I'll never have support. So it was this idea of how do me or us as clinicians assist people with kind of seeing, quote unquote, the silver lining or helping them to navigate their strengths to create, you know, the outcome they would like to see, even in isolation. And it's been a task.
Why would you say it's been a task? Is it because of that interpersonal relationship of like not being able to be in front of somebody? Or why would you say that? Yeah.
Well, and then you have to add in pandemic happened because of COVID-19. So the idea, right. I don't want to get sick. I'm scared to get sick. I see sickness all over, you know, TV and social media. I'm also not quite aware if I can get sick. So it's this whole idea of I'm just going to close myself off from the world until it's perceived as safe. However, what happened was when I closed myself off, I'm with myself more. or I'm with my triggers more. I'm with my environmental stressors more. Mm. So we were able to see domestic violence go up. We were able to see hunger go up. We were able to kind of see child neglect go up. The reason why I said kind of see was because some of the children, they weren't in a school building. So the reporting kind of went down on that. But when you get clients that come in, or you get teen clients, you know, who come in and they start to share their fears and their anxieties, you start to pinpoint like, oh, okay, something's not happening well at home. So yeah, social isolation caused a lot of people to sit with themselves or yeah. with the thing that they were distracted with other things to be away from.
Yeah. Okay. So now the transition going back into the real world, because I feel like a lot of people are very eager to do that. Like, oh, things are back open. Let me go dive back in. Is that smart? Should we be kind of like pacing ourselves to go back, or is it, what is the professional perspective with that?
And everyone will say something different too. But I would say that we're on a continuum, right? We're on the spectrum. You know, some people have been doing and living their best life, even during COVID, as safely as possible. But there are still some who are just like, well, I don't know. So it depends on where you are on the continuum of social safety and precautions. Here's what I think is best. I think that we should probably phase ourselves into social interactions or being, you know, back to normal. You know, go and do some experiential type things. Go sit in a coffee shop, see how it makes you feel. Yeah. If you're not even there yet, go sit in a parking lot and see how that makes you feel. Mm-hmm. You know, if you want to go in grocery shop, I started doing online shopping. That was the best thing that ever happened to my life. Mm-hmm. I will never probably go back and do grocery shopping in person again.
That's
but, you know, just kind of do some experiential type things. Go to places that you used to go to. Give yourself some time and assess how you feel. And if you feel okay, stay a little longer. If you're like, nope, too early, go back home.
All right, that sounds good to me. I will be following that as well. as far as age groups or any demographic, is one more susceptible to anxieties, either pre or post pandemic, than others? Or is everyone kind of on the same playing field? And what are some things that we could do besides kind of waiting back in that can kind of ease the process of transition?
Well, I mean, I also think I haven't really seen age differences. For instance, some of my, you know, 30 and up was like, I'm a homebody anyway, so this didn't bother me.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you do have your early 20s and your teens are just like, I just can't do this anymore. I'm going to the party. I'm going to the kickback. So, you know, there has been some of that. Well, there are some, I have to do a lot of informed, you know, choice. Like, you know, there are risks for that. Yeah, but I'm okay. You live once, you know. So I think the idea is basically to scan not just age, but also to scan readiness. And that could be at any age frame or time frame. What I will say, though, Rhea, is we can't demonize somebody for what they want to do. We can't scold somebody for what they want to do. But I think the best thing that we can do is make sure that they have their safety parameters in place and allow them to use that as they want. Another thing that I would also say is, you know, I am fully vaccinated. I fought it for a very, very long time. But I had a lot of people close to me and near me in my circles that were dying. And so we might want to be talking about vaccine too. The benefits of being vaccinated so that you can have those freedoms to do what you'd like to do.
All right. Thank you so much, Breanne Ward, for being with us today.
You're welcome. And
we'll be right back after this.
Enjoy a slice of the sweet.
New CDC data shows Iowa's doing well when it comes to caring for those living with HIV or AIDS. The report is from data compiled in 2019. Iowa is the second best state at getting those living with HIV on viral suppressants. The state has reduced the number of diagnoses from 2015 to 2019 by nearly 30%. Last year's data is supposed to be coming out soon, but while we continue to take a closer look at LGBTQ plus issues this Pride Month, we're taking a look at the misconceptions that persist about HIV and AIDS.
When people first receive their diagnosis of HIV and they come to their first visit, a lot of them are very distraught. And I think the big concern is that they do have this vision of what HIV and AIDS was like in the 80s and early 90s before we had good medications. What I tend to tell these people is to reassure them that the diagnosis of HIV is really no longer a death sentence, and hasn't been for the past decade or so. So if we catch someone who has HIV and they can get a diagnosis before their immune system is damaged, we can get them on medications that can essentially make it so that the HIV virus is no longer circulating in their blood, and can prevent the HIV from progressing to AIDS. We don't have a cure for HIV yet, so even though we can get the levels of HIV to decrease in the amount in the blood, it's still hiding in their body, but it doesn't cause the immune system damage that it would cause without the medications. Historically, it was felt to be that is the highest risk people, but they have found that recently, the rate of HIV is rising in heterosexual people as well. And so I do think that it's important for people to realize that it's not only a disease that men who have sex with men get, but that can be transmitted through heterosexual encounters as well, and also things like IV drug use.
Thank you for joining us. Have a great Sunday.